And so I'm going to look at a couple passages, actually. Proverbs 28, 1 through 4, and Isaiah 59, 1 through 4 as well. But I wanted to take a look at something really interesting because of my testimony, which is quite a bit behind us now. It's been a while since that happened to me, my great experience. I call it my Ezekiel chapter 8 experience. But while I was able to see this vision of the church, it was the Lord used this honeycomb upon the earth for me to see. It was very, very, very strange to me because I've never known there to be any type of connection with the cosmos and honeycomb shapes. And I didn't know what it was for quite a long time, but I think because after years, I realized that the church to Christ is very sweet, but it's broken. And that's what he showed me, a broken honeycomb over the earth. As I was 100 miles away from the earth looking down. And just now there's a new telescope that came out that is probably one of the most powerful telescopes that's ever existed, called the JWST. Some gentleman with his J and his last name W, and then Space Telescope. And the thing is shaped in the shape of a honeycomb on the front and on the sides of it as well. Very, very interesting. It just popped back to my memory because it's kind of going crazy all over the web right now. I've seen artwork along the walls in Grand Rapids downtown that was also about like outer space, and it had a lot of the shapes of a honeycomb as well. And it was artwork in the Aliens exhibit in Kentucky, and Ken Ham's exhibit here. It's Alien Fact or Fiction, and in that video you could see a lot of the shapes of honeycombs in there as well. And I've looked up online just to see if there was anything. Kind of keeps on clicking. I realized that there's not a lot, but there was a few connections to the cosmos and to the honeycomb. I say that to let you know that I'd like to validate some of the things that the Lord has shown me, because I believe everything the Lord has shown me has eventually been proven to be true. Very, very interesting thing that he has shown us. But this is a very interesting thing. After God shows you something so significant, it's hard to ever want to let it go. You know that the Lord is expecting us to hold on to this vision here. And I want to say this because I have something very, very important to talk about tonight. I'm trying to be able to look at the gospel into a fresh light. But we'll get into this in just a second. We're going to cover that in just a moment. But let's look at Proverbs chapter 28 first. The first four verses, because I want us to be able to see something really important as we lay down the text, and we'll get into several thoughts leading back into these passages. First is Proverbs 28, verses 1 through 4. The wicked flee when no man pursueth, but the righteous are bold as a lion. For the transgression of a land, many are princes thereof, but a man of understanding and knowledge, the state thereof shall be prolonged. A poor man that oppresseth the poor is like a sweeping rain which leaveth no food. They that forsake the law praise the wicked, but such as keep the law contend with them. The wicked flee when no man pursueth, but the righteous are bold as a lion. For the transgression of the land, many are the princes thereof, but by a man of understanding and knowledge, the state thereof shall be prolonged. A poor man that oppresseth the poor is like a sweeping rain which leaveth no food. Let's go ahead and pray, and we will get back to this in just a moment here in the next text as well. Heavenly Father, we thank you for tonight that we can gather in your powerful name, God. I thank you, Lord, that you are our Lord. And I thank you, Lord, that you have called us to gather in your name, that we can remember the things that matters most, the things that you have said, things that you have directed us in to help us get our thoughts together, a place of sanctuary, a safety from the storm of the mindsets of this world, Lord, that is never ending. And we're always going to need a sanctuary. We're always going to need you, God, to be our hideaway. Lord, I pray that the person of your Son will be our portion and will be the sole passion of our whole entire life, that we will live to the praise of your glory, of your grace, all the days of our life. Lord, I pray that our life would be a poured out drink offering before you, that the world may see your light through us. I praise you and thank you in your son's precious name. Amen. So here we see something really interesting. The wicked flee when no man pursueth, but the righteous are bold as a lion. Showing you the contrast here in the first verse. For the transgression of a land, many are the princes thereof. When you see a sinful land, a land going into sin, a lot of leadership is leading that direction. But by a man of understanding and knowledge, the state thereof shall be prolonged. You know, like we saw when the Lord was willing to spare Sodom and Gomorrah for the life of even five. He said, even for five righteous I would not destroy. So that even though the nations are led in extreme unrighteousness, you'll see that the righteous who are really seeing God and His Word for who and what it is, this will prolong the judgment. They will be able to live longer, knowing that there is some salt and some light in this world. I will prolong to give them a longer chance to come to terms. A poor man that oppresseth the poor is like a sweeping rain which leaveth no food. Almost like the blind leading the blind. You know, it's just a poor man. We're going to get into this a little bit more later on, but the poor man oppresseth the poor. There's a mindset where you're always seeing things under a light that will cause you to never do anything but sink. And you have a lot in common with other people who think like you, and then you come along them and they both just continue to go down. There's nothing left. People who win the lottery and 5 years later, they're the brokest person in the world because they don't have, it's not the money that they needed, it's the mindset of success that they needed. And then you get people who are successful, they're always extra successful. If they're poor people, they always are extra poor. It's a kind of interesting, the mindsets that can lead to success and the mindsets that lead to failure. Eternally, naturally, what anything, it's kind of the same philosophy, again, the same principles when people understand. People who like to be an island, they want to be just me and just give me what I need, and they forget everybody else, and eventually you'll realize this is the mindset of where you're going to come up lacking oftentimes. They that forsake the law praise the wicked. You leave the ways of God's ways, and you're going to honor those who are wicked. You're going to honor those who are the stars of the world, the stars in government, the stars in the national leading, international leading. When you don't care about the laws of God, you're not going to have the heart or the sight of your soul to honor that which is right overall. Maybe you'll get some things right, but overall you're going to praise the wicked. But such as keep the law, contend with them. Those that keep the law are going to contend with those that forsake the law. We're not going to be in agreement with each other. God often leaves some type of a government where everybody can live somewhat peaceably together, and we have a substantial law where everybody is able to practice within reason their understandings and their beliefs. I wanted to get into some more things. I want to lay down the doctrine of the groom. According to the old dictionary that I have that I used to believe in all completely, but now I'm starting to wonder because I've seen something very interesting in here. The old dictionary definition calling the groom a boy or a young man or a waiter or a servant, a man or a boy who takes charge over horses. And then the fourth one here is where it starts to get confusing. It says groom for goom. Take the R out. It's called goom. In the 1828 dictionary, Noah Webster's dictionary, in bridegroom, this is the first time you see it, says is a palpable mistake. A palpable mistake. They don't believe that groom means man. It just means servant or something like that. And they almost had me for a second there, but it's actually not true. And now it says bridegroom. Bridegroom showing all the different types of, like a man, basically a bride. Whenever you see the word bride, it usually means right before you get married or newlywed. That's pretty much what bride where is. And if you say bridegroom, according to this, it means, well, we know it as bridegroom. And I don't know why they have it different in this. It's very strange why there's some type of a contention from Noah Webster and the King James Bible. I don't understand the problem. But that's what that's teaching. It's teaching about the bridegroom, meaning about a man before he gets married, or a man that's after he's recently married. It's a newlywed. So bride is usually around the time of the wedding and the timeline of close to the actual wedding situation. And here, what you see in the dictionary, bridegroom, it just says see bridegroom. I don't know why that is an issue, but it is for some reason with him. And here we are to the bride. Quickly, just to come here, it shows that a woman who is new married by the name is applied to a woman at the marriage festival before she is married as well as after the ceremony. So recently married for the bride, and a woman is spoused by or contracted to be married. So basically it's just the same thing. Whenever you see the name bride, it's for a man or a woman. It's for the connection between when she's about to be married or when she's already married. I wanted to lay that down because I thought it was interesting. I wanted to know why does the Bible call a man or Christ the bridegroom? Why is the word bride there at all? I don't know what, I guess bride just means wedding, and men and women can be, but the bride, what it calls in here, groom, but the Bible calls it bridegroom, so that's what I'm going to stick with, actually, is the bridegroom. We'll be getting back to that in a little bit as we look at the main text here. See, here's the word bridegroom. As you see, it's in the Bible numerous times, probably at least 20 or so times. So you can see that it's been on here tons of times, so to say that bridegroom is the issue is just false. So that's one thing I want to lay down, but let's look up one more thing to get some more introduction laid down is Isaiah chapter 59:1-4. Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, neither his ear heavy that it cannot hear. But your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear. For your hands are defiled with blood, and your fingers with iniquity. Your lips have spoken lies, your tongue hath muttered perverseness. None calleth for justice, nor any pleadeth for truth. They trust in vanity and speak lies. They conceive mischief and bring forth iniquity. So we see here this type of a reasoning why there's a separation between God's people and God himself. It says, but your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear. You know, have you ever felt like God's not hearing your prayers? Sometimes he's waiting on legitimate basis when we are okay, but other times I think there's an issue. There could be a thing that he wants us to know about. He wants us to know. And that's why I like bringing up marriage a lot. I think, like I had brought up before, about the two different main focuses of the church. And I'm going to say it plainly, that if these two things are not a very mighty focus of the church will never be able to reproduce the next generation. They will not be able to. Evangelism and family. And when we take the time to do those two things right, we will not have time for all the nonsense that's going to allow all these things that God says that's going to separate us. We're not going to have time for these things. We're not going to have these idle hands. We will not have time for the nonsense that seems to permeate the body of Christ. When we neglect the family, we're going to be the spiritual know-it-alls that always put down the church and what have you, like a lot of the internet people do, a lot of the street preachers do, a lot of the different Lone Rangers and cults do. But yet it's really not understanding that the family situation is right. They're right about the family. But the families need to know that evangelism, like I said last week, it's still a very, very massive focus. If we don't take time to pour into the next generation, the devil will gladly do it for us. And all that makes up the two main focuses of the Christian church, everything will be touched if we focus so severely on evangelism, because now we're going to know we must stand righteously if we're going to affect the world, if we're going to be the salt and light, if we're going to have a real testimony that's going to touch them, we're going to have a testimony that touches us. That means we're going to have to really seek the Lord. And for family as well, so much problems in this world can be solved just by focusing on the family. All the money that goes into it, all the order of the home, and all the faithfulness that is required to do everything, and everybody taking their position in there. This is the shield that will protect the families, and thus protect the church and protect the nations as well. So the question is, who is discipling the next generation? The people of God or the people of the world system? Like I said, if the people of God are not going to be the salt and light, the world system will gladly take over where we left off, and they will pour into this next generation, and the next generation will have a lot less Christians or a lot less strong Christians, and the families will be more messed up, the churches will be more empty, and the churches will be more compromised, because the world is kind of influencing the church instead of the church influencing the world, because we're not raising up the disciples, the next generation. Who's discipling the next generation? Is it the people of God, or is it the people of the world system? People who are consumed with their current page will likely not hear your message, but those who are lacking and maybe in need and maybe get a little help from us are more likely to hear our message. Could we imagine if the church, who had strong homes and strong families and strong church communities, took the time to win the lost souls, not to transfer from church to church? Would you like to come to our church, church member? This is not evangelism. This is just transplanting. That's a whole nother... It doesn't take much to do that, because they already know. You're just building on someone else's foundations is all that really is. But I think there's something we can take a look at here to help shock us into reality tonight. There's a lot of things that are going to be shocking us into reality tonight. Paris Reed had a message that he goes over, which I plan on watching for the rest of my life. Two series that he does, the So Great Salvation series and the Evidences of Eternal Life series. He starts off by saying, you know, and he was speaking this 40 years ago, and he says, some of the historical giants that we've all looked back to and honored as great men of God had some very interesting things to say. And this could be like 40, 50, 60, 70 years old of messages and quotes that he's quoting from like A.W. Tozer and a couple other giants that we look back to. But we got to look to these things that they're saying that are extremely profound to cause an alertness and an awakening to the hearts of the church today. That they said only 1 out of 10 evangelicals show biblical evidences of being born again. Only 1 out of 10 evangelicals show biblical evidences of being born again. And I think that's a pretty shocking thought to think. How, if things are not being passed down to generation to generation, if we're not getting stronger as a church, and we're not being more effective, we're not seeing greater things happen, more missions and all this, then something, it's either going up or it's going down. I don't think it's really staying the same. If we see 80 years ago, it would have been unheard of. The bikini wasn't even invented yet. I mean, it was unthinkable. The only people who were willing to model for the bikini when it came out was people who were already doing things that they ought not do. No model would do it. They had to be much more great. They had to be much more foul than that. The only people who were willing to do this was prostitutes. They were the ones who were willing to wear these things. And that's what it was when those things came out quite many, many decades ago. And back then, when we had a lot more strictness in the laws, people used to dress morally. People dressed like they did today 80 years ago, they'd probably be locked up in the nut house, or they'd probably be locked up into prison, because America used to have standards. So even back then, when there was many more standards than we have, when the laws used to exist that actually made a little bit of sense, a lot more sense than today, even back then, they said 1 out of 10 evangelicals are showing biblical evidence of being born again. But what about today? What about today? Where are we today? Are we judging ourselves and our salvation and our faith by what's going on around us? Or are we judging it by the revelation of Jesus Christ? Are we doing it by the real salvation? We're going to look at salvation as well in a little while. All that's going into the family is being under attack for generations by now. All that goes into what makes a family strong is all under attack. The men, you know, from the cartoons, like The Simpsons, and trying to make men think it's funny to be, you know, very naive and silly, like Homer Simpson and a lot of other shows. I don't have a lot to do with them, so I don't really know what's up and coming. I'm just using examples of how the TV is trying to make you see things under a false light. Ultimately, there's a worldview that takes the Lord off of his throne. It takes him off of his throne. We don't get to see God ruling from the throne of God. We get to take him off his throne and imagine the world in another, under another light. And the television is going to be very happy to help you think that way. And also, all that goes into evangelism has also been under attack for generations now. Filling the church with worldly music, filling the churches with compromise and legal rights to embrace the filth of the world and think that it's going to be okay. But when we did that, it might have seemed fine when we had a blessing there. Hey, nothing's wrong right now. But the next generation is going to take that and keep going down and down and down. Who is influencing the next generation? Who's evangelizing them? Is it us? Are we really passing down the strong truth of God, where they're going to build strong families and build strong evangelism, that we will not become extinct? We need revival in the family. and revival in evangelism. These two focus and mandates will virtually take care of all the problems that we have today. The two focuses will deliver us from our careless slumber that will cost us much more than we anticipate. Just like Jack Chick said in one of his comic books that he got from Finney, he says, if we don't bring revival, the only thing we can expect is martyrdom. Because the system that we are believing in, more than God's word, is setting us up to helping us remove our heads. They're going to put us in concentration camps eventually if we don't continue to follow their ways. If we don't become salt and light and demand that God does something mighty and God makes them listen, because he's the only one who can make them listen. We have some power, but by now they've gained a lot of ground. It's going to be really difficult to see it happen. So if we don't have revival, this was written decades ago. We will have nothing to guarantee but concentration camps and martyrdom. We need to bring back what we lost and be willing to take the correction we need to be all we can be for our husband, the bridegroom. Jesus is the bridegroom of the body of Christ, also known as the bride of Christ. The two focuses of evangelism and family, that is our call as Christians, that we are not to dissipate from, or not to alleviate these. We need to bring back what we've lost, the passion for souls, the passion for a strong home and family and community. We have to be willing to take the correction and say, Lord, we know we're wrong. That's all there is to it. We're busted. We got to get back. Some people lose ground because of difficult things that they've gone through. They go through pain and they lose ground. I remember in John Wesley's story, there was a man that tried to kill John Wesley because he needed money to fix his friend's broken leg. He was desperate. Someone says, if you go kill John Wesley, I'll give you enough money to fix your friend's leg. You know, that happens in movies. I've seen people turn to the dark side because they want to save someone's life and whatever. They thought that they could get some help from the bad guys, and eventually it costs you. Something happens to you when it happens that way. Famous people going to drugs because of the hurt that they've gone through. People losing ground because of pain. We got to be careful what happens when we get hurt in this world, because sometimes when we're hurt, if we don't have the right kind of people to get around us, somebody's going to be influencing us, and if it's not a godly people, it's going to be something else that's going to lead us to these cycles, that's going to continue us on cycles that will not be victorious. Learning patience by staying on the word and being rooted and planted is very, very important for all believers, and that's something I've been dealing with, and the Lord's been showing me how I really need to be more patient as well. Patient is an interesting thing I heard recently that is actually a difficult thing, because patience just means I am not getting now what I want. It's something's making me wait for what I want, and I'm forced to be patient or demand that I want this. And when we're not patient, we're going to be upset, because we're not like the interpreter on Pilgrim's Progress says, there's a patient one and there's one who's patient, one who's patient and one who's demanding and screaming that he wants what he wants right now. And he says one will not be happy when it's all said and done. One will wait for the eternal prize. I'm going to be patient. I'll take what you want me to have, Lord. I'll work hard, but I'm going to take what you want me to have and be content with what you have. I'm okay with what you give me, Lord. The process of growing means that we need to grow. When we are impatient with others when they need to grow, but we need to know that others are waiting for us as well to grow. The Screwtape Letters book teaches that. The adult demon teaching the younger demon how to teach his subjects to focus on the wrongs of everybody else, but to not realize their own imperfections that anybody else who can see them can see very easily. Help them to focus on what's wrong with everybody else, says the devil, but don't let them see what's wrong with their own selves, so they don't know that we all need to grow. If we know that we can grow further, then we know that we are imperfect people working with imperfect people. And the more developed in the word we get, the more we're planted, the more we're going to understand how it really works and how hard it is to really overcome in our life, so then we're going to be more merciful for others when they're growing as well. Decision making is more difficult in certain situations, so we need to be wise as to which mode we need to switch into. If we are driving on a fairly empty freeway, then it's easy and not much to concern, but if it's construction, then we have to kind of tighten up and slow down. And if we're driving through Chicago, of course, we got to brace yourself and really hold on for dear life out there, because it's just such an aggressive vibe in the busy cities. There's different vibes depending on what's going on. Our decision making is difficult in decisions and such like this. So We got to be careful when we're making our decisions in tight modes like this, because we might, you know, we might not always make the right decision. Driving through sketchy areas in Grand Rapids, and then watch out for the daily fender benders, because there's a lot of wrecks even in this city, and it's not that big of a city actually. Another thing we got to keep in mind: how to know that we are getting into the flesh. Do you ever go back to that which you have left behind when you first were saved? Whatever you left behind when you first got saved is the world to you. Whatever you were delivered from is the world to you. Then this thought begs the question: did you leave your self life behind in the first place, or did you never truly understand the gospel to begin with? Because when we come to Jesus, we take on his ways and we lose our ways. And that's what salvation is. It's like we come to his word and we leave our own word. We take his truth and we leave our lies. We take his life and we leave our life behind. That's what it should have been in the first place. So if we never had to drop our own ways to pick up his ways, is there a testimony to look at in our past at all? If our testimony is not truly touching us, it's not going to touch anybody else. So that's where the evangelism will cause us to check ourselves. Why is my gospel not teaching anybody? Why is it not touching anybody? Why do I have to play all these little silly games to try to get their attention? Because our gospel must touch us first before we can touch the lost and dying world. If we can adore him privately, we can declare him publicly. Amen. If there was a real touch of God to begin with, will he not see it through to completion? He's faithful and just to complete the work that he has begun. We're not seeing this happen, and maybe you are hibernating at this point and ready to feel the summer weather come again, when the revival comes again and totally renews you in the presence of God. Brothers and sisters, summer is on the way. He's going to warm our hearts once again. He's going to warm up our faith once again. Don't lose hope in the tight spots, in the difficult places. It's called the refiner's fire. I think that's one of the most important things about marriage, is it's a refining fire. It causes us to see things that the Lord has been trying to tell us all of our life. He's like, well, if you don't see it now in your own heart, don't worry. When you get married, you will, because your spouse will not be okay with the things you've been doing that I've been hoping you'd learn. But this way, I'm going to make you learn. That's why God loves marriage so much, because it helps complete the work. It's like an accountability partner in a certain kind of way. And when people become one flesh in marriage, the details are heightened. Every little thing that your spouse does, now it becomes a much bigger deal than before you knew them, because it didn't really matter that much. You wish good for everybody, but now it becomes extremely important that every little thing is right. And that's exactly what the Holy Spirit speaks. When he speaks, every little thing must be just like this. I'm caring about the way you see things, the way your heart is. God says the refiner's fire in relationships is very key. How we are in romantic relationship for marriage, how we are in friendships, how we are in business, and how we are with the community. A refiner's fire, when we get around other people, it's going to cause us to see who we really are into different little mirrors. We can check ourselves here. This is where the Lord is able to bring things out in our heart that has never been dealt with yet. So when you come into different relationships of any sort, things start to pop up and you're like, whoa, look, I didn't realize I had that in there. And the Lord says, it's always been there, and this is the time for you to confess it and say, this is my responsibility, and I will pull it out of you and cleanse you and make you more pure in the refiner's fire, make you pure as gold. Many connections that God has brought us into is all the places where we can see who we really are and not who we assume in the paths that we have been in all along. New paths are going to cause us to see things in our heart that we never knew existed. It's only a different level of refining fire. Amen. We feel things that are not really there and respond as if they are real. I like this thought from a movie called The Young Sherlock Holmes film. I haven't watched movies in a long, long time because I don't like them, but I like learning from them. Young Sherlock Holmes, in this movie, happened where these very creepy people, these Egyptian scary people who were living underground, and they were doing this like very strange cult where they're putting people in mummies and all this stuff, very creepy. But not only did that, they would find somebody that they didn't like, and they would kind of sneak out into the community and they would do a blow dart into someone's neck. And they would go, oh, what happened? They thought it was a mosquito or something. But within 10 or 15 minutes, they would start to hallucinate and see things that really were not there, but they looked very, very real. Could you imagine if you had a teddy bear in your house, and all of a sudden it came alive and started attacking you, and you'd be like so scared you would go into a whole other frame of mind, panic and do something crazy, and ultimately end up dying. That's what happened every time. Every time someone happened, is they did things start moving around, and they'd start seeing things that really weren't there. And they were basically, like the Bible says, they were running when no man pursueth. The wicked run when no man pursueth, but the righteous are bold like lions. They're not going to be hallucinating and believing things that aren't really there. They're going to know this ain't real, and I'm not going to run from it. When the system's saying, hey, do this now, and all the people who are not walking right with God, they're going to just follow suit. Whatever the TV says, they're just going to do it. Oh, here's another thing coming on. We better follow that. And they're running when there's nothing there. And it's very, very scary to see how people are so willing to listen. If you were lost in the Word of God, if you were in evangelism, you were focusing on family, focusing on the church, and what the Word of God teaches us to do, we would not be falling for all these hallucinations. There was a bad guy that would do this, shooting people, and they'd get all this stuff, and they'd run into panic and kill themselves. But the cause, of course, was obviously on purpose, and it's the cause from all the other lies that are going on is also very purposeful, to try to knock off people who are going to believe everything that they hear. One time, Sherlock's friend was shot in the neck, and he had to scream to them, don't respond, it's not real, don't do it. They were like freaking out, thinking the skeletons were chasing them and trying to strangle them and everything, and they were panicking, and he said, don't listen, it's not real. That's what the Word of God is telling us. Brothers and sisters in Christ, stop running from this stuff. I am your God. I will protect you. You're not going to have to run from these things. It's not there. Don't run when there's nothing really wrong. On the things that we need to learn as leaders is how to deal with irrational people. A lot of people who are, there's nothing really wrong, but everything in their own mind is just always wrong. Everything's negative. Everything's always bad. And I've seen some people who have seemed to master this skill much better than I, who know how to handle that. I've seen people in restaurants, and they handle people who are not very polite customers, and then they're really polite and handling it very well. I was like, man, I could learn from the McDonald's guy, or I could learn from the manager at the restaurant who has got an irate customer, and learning how to handle that. But, you know, as a street preacher, I generally tend to be very direct, which I know is good in some ways, but in my daily life, it's not always the right spirit. I got to discern. And sometimes I'm very direct, and that is of the flesh, and that's not right. But when we get strong in the Lord further, we will be able to handle a lot more unreasonable people that are running for nothing, and handle them in a Christ-like manner. People get into a panic in the store. They're waiting 1 minute longer in the line than they need to, and they're getting all huffy-puffy and whatever. People on the freeways are all bent out of shape and getting really testy and such like this. And it's important that I don't feed off of that. I need to feed off the Word and learn how to handle these people who are like that. I don't want to run when there's nothing really wrong like they are, and I'm going to follow into that, or that's not true. The unrighteous run, but no man pursueth, but the righteous are bold like a lion. This type of mindset would become a homeless drunk after giving them a $1 billion mansion. They will find a way to burn it to the ground and become worth far less than they had begun. So many people who have a massive amount of money commit suicide. It's not even about that. There's nothing wrong, but they just don't see it because they thought that money was everything, and then they realize they have the money, and it's still, they feel like they're missing something. Something's really wrong. Some people who have so much material wealth are still miserable and can't for their life figure out what's wrong with them. They're just running from nothing, like, what's going on? I thought I was onto something. No, it's not right. Not right. We don't need to run when nothing's really there, amen. Ever bought a house? Anybody ever bought a house? I've actually looked into that a few different times. It's quite a bit of a process in order to get into your new home. No one on earth, not even the angels or devils, wants to be homeless. I don't know what angels' homes is. I think their habitation is just heaven. But we do know that the fallen angels are able to possess people. They're able to get into people and control them. I think there's different levels of how they can get into people's lives, whether it's mentally in a soulful area, or can they actually get into your spirit and cause you to do things that is very, very crazy and lose control of yourself. I don't believe a real born-again Christian can be possessed, but I do believe that demons can oppress Christians for sure. They can attack people when they're not in the right spot that they should be. I said they don't like it either. How do people get into their home, and how do demons get into their new home? I first thought that they must speak to the subject and make that person think or go into a certain direction that isn't true. to God's original plan. And of course, they're going to have, then that demon will have a legal right to live inside of that person, though, to some degree, depending on the crime or depending on the departure or the light that person ever had in the first place. But if a demon can sneak to a person and start to talk to them and get them to think wrong, eventually the spirit will start to be able to take residence there, because he's able to move where the lie is happening. He said, I'm a lying devil, and I can't live in this person unless I get them to lie like I do. Or I can't get this person to be my home unless I can do this right. I don't think the angels can live inside of people, but they can aid them and even materialize to help people as if they were just another person. I believe that, according to Hebrews 13:1. But in the natural, people need to get a legal entry to a home. And in the spirit, demons need to get legal entry into their homes. Houses are our homes, and bodies are their homes. The only way to be sure, sometimes, this is kind of an attitude, I think we need to go into this mode. We have to know, as body of Christ, to discern, like William Dumas was really good at this because he really saw it. Should we go into gentle mode, or should we go into nuke mode? I remember there was a movie one time where there was a lot of really, really deadly problems going on. They said the only way to be sure is to escape this place, go into orbit and nuke the entire site just to make sure that this big problem is completely dealt with, because this is very bad. We've already lost enough of our soldiers. We need to just bomb this whole thing to make sure that nothing is ever going to go wrong again. And that's, sometimes we have to go into extreme mode of just get it gone, just destroy it, get out of your life, like whip all that many changes out of the marketplace, get radical with it sometimes. And sometimes you see like how Jesus handles things very, very delicately. And one-on-one, he's explaining things carefully with people lovingly. We don't want to, there's some things that are so delicate, you don't want to clean it with a scouring pad. Like if you had crystal dishes or something, you don't want to scour it because it's the wrong tools for that. You have to be careful. You have to go into delicate mode. But there's other times you're going to have to get the sand blaster out and clean things up really, really well. Same things in our spiritual life as well. Some things are not fine and they never will be, so we've got to go very strong on those things, get very radical in our decisions. When we get to know the Lord clearer and clearer, we will be able to discern when to be patient and careful and when to go into orbit and nuke the entire site just to be sure it's done and done. So what about this crucifixion? We crucify the flesh once and for all. Sometimes you got to get radical in your decisions about your plans and how you're going to be in these right places. You're not going to have so much idle time to have problems try to arise and what have you. There are many mighty acts of the Spirit of God that can happen in our lives as long as we are all ready to get out the nuclear weapons and make some drastic changes in our lives. There are many mighty acts of the Spirit of God that can happen in our lives as long as we are ready to get out the nuclear weapons, so to speak, and make some dramatic changes in our lives. I tell you, when the Lord has spoken to me for real, it wasn't just a thought or a feeling or a verse. It was truly a divine revelation of God, like I showed you about earlier. I showed you about how the Lord spoke to me, and I said, wow, Lord. No one's ever going to believe me. This is just so different than where the church is today. And that's exactly what he showed me. That there is a soulful understanding of Christianity, and then there's a supernatural version of Christianity that we've got to get back to, where we come into divine revelation of Jesus Christ. It's exactly what the Bible says, that the gospel really is, and real salvation. It ought to be spiritual, so we're spirit-led and fully consecrated. So all these things that the old history giants have been saying, all the revivalists have always saying, it will make perfect sense. The soul and spirit division is where the miracles actually can happen. When we take the word of God as it is written and not as it has been interpreted by the blind leading the blind. Sometimes we need to go in and to the wow. We are way off track. Let's not kid ourselves anymore. We need to nuke this entire place. We are so far off. All of our plans, we got to nuke all of our plans, they're just wrong. All we got to do is just get back on our knees and look for the Lord's Spirit again and let Him show us what's really right and wrong. In the Spirit, it's very easy to see what's right and wrong. And this is the reason why some preachers will preach with such intensity, because they must have had a real touch of God and made them realize we have got to quit playing the patient and kind path. We need to annihilate the whole thing. Thus saith the Lord, we are way off track. Red alert, code blue, an old-fashioned clarion call for radical repentance. My house shall be called the house of prayer, he says. Is it nice to cut somebody open? Yes, if you are a trained surgeon and doing legitimate work, then yes, get in there and cut that cancer out now if you want to have a ghost of a chance of saving that life. Amen. There's some things that just got to get cut out. That's how we really got to deal with things very, very significantly. Some things might not sound right under a certain light, but if someone really knows the discerning work of the Holy Spirit, they're going to show you the real deal, and you will declare the glories of God in your life. Another tactic of the devil, like we talked about last week, there was several, and the new one about the sellout doctrine that we've seen, how the Satan kind of tries to get into families and churches and what have you. This is one called the familiarity card, and I said it like this, that we are such creatures of habit, and at times it can sneak up on us if we are not careful. Have you ever seen something so wrong and yet still gave it a chance? It's amazing how we are so ready to let folks in our path when they show so many warning signs, and only when it all blows up do we ever come back to our senses again. That's happened to me with different ministers. I tried to get around. I knew that they were wrong, but I started to slowly over quite a long time gave them a chance and what have you, and it was just a big mess, as I should have known in the first place. I didn't know. But all of a sudden, it seemed like the devil tries to get you to be familiar with things that you know is not right. And then eventually it becomes the norm for you and becomes familiar. And that which once was clearly wrong, all of a sudden now it becomes your new home plate. Now you're comfortable there. It's like how people get captured and they go into trafficking, and now all of a sudden their family finally finds them a year or so later and they bring them back home, and the person's like, I don't even know how to be here anymore. I'd rather go back. And they go back to being trafficked because that's what they know now. It's become familiar to them. Very, very interesting. People go out of jail and they do something bad to get thrown back into jail because they're institutionalized. They get so familiar. It's a familiarity card. And the devil tries to get you familiar with things that is not wholesome and not healthy and not holy. Another tactic is really strange I've seen happen. I remember one guy I was playing video games with a long time ago, and I thought about this the other day, that our pizza didn't come on time when it was supposed to be delivered, and he says, I know how to get a free pizza. Watch this. He calls the place and sits there and starts talking really snotty to them and being really rude to them and being very impatient and all this stuff and saying, you know, that's not fair. We ordered the pizza. And they said, okay, calm down. We'll give you the pizza for free. It's like, okay, thank you. And so then he showed us how to get a pizza for free by being a jerk. But you know, I've actually seen people who are the sweetest, kindest people. They had very excellent people skills. And everywhere they go, people couldn't help but give them things because it was so fun to give good people things. So they became like, they got a lot of things because they were kind to people. And other people have to be snotty and mean and unkind. And then they get stuff because people are just trying to get them out of your way. They're not thinking good things about you when it's all said and done. So overall, you might have got some things, but look what you had to do to get it. Look what you had to do to shame the name of the Lord just to get it. It's not right. Now, this is kind of a main topic tonight I wanted to get into. I thought it was pretty significant. I call it legal separation. The legal separation. It's a very, very interesting thought. Now, I want to put this in perspective because I really, God bless you, church. But I want the church to see this very serious. Look at the insanity of this thought here. Pretend your son is in custody and you can't have him for maybe a year or so because someone accused you of misconduct with your son. So they took him away for a year and you can't even deal with it. And then the system says, you know what? We really care for you, and we want you to have a cardboard cutout of your son. Would that be okay? Would you be settled with that? And they would probably say, no, of course not. Is that next silly question? Or maybe we can give you a book that's got all kinds of nice facts about your son. Would that be okay? Or do you actually want the person? They're like, no, I don't want a book about my son. I need my son. I'll take the cardboard cutout. I'll take the book, but I need my son. That's the whole point. Or have another foster child that we can give in place of your original son. Would that be okay? And they'd be like, no, it's not okay. Or we could give you a weekly meeting about your son. You can just gather with people and just talk about your son all the time and never really have him. Or if you want to wait the year for the legal issue, or you want to pay the real fine, or you want to cross all the red tape that we show you, And we need to examine your conduct to make sure that you can have him legally back. You can actually have the son back again when you're really willing to pay the real price. Or someone tries to get a marriage in trouble by lying against the husband. The bridegroom, as we called him, is legally taken away from you, taken away from the bride. The newlyweds are here, and now the bridegroom has been lied against. The system takes him away from her. Very interesting. I'm going to lay it out like this. The devil tripped up what I call the great-great-great-grandfather. His name was Adam in the beginning. And he brought sin into the world. And now sin has separated us from the bridegroom, as we have seen. Our sins have separated us. Our iniquities have separated us from God. He brought sin into the world to separate us from God, and now we have to wait upon him and wait for him to speak. And he waits for us to seek, and then we wait for him to speak. God is looking for people. Who's going to seek my face? If you really seek my face and prove to me over the years that you're really looking for me over the seasons, then I will speak to you because you're actually seeking my face and not settling for a cardboard cutout church. You're not settling for just the book. And that's enough for you. You're not settling for a carbon copy or another Jesus or another gospel or another spirit. You actually want the real thing. And you're on your knees saying, enough is enough. You don't know God. Lord, I need to know you for myself. The Lord's waiting for you to seek. Then he will speak in his time. Third example here. Say there's a house you want to build just the way you like it. And there's a property that you want to build it on. And it is legally separated from you because of the bank is holding it up. Would you like to have a cardboard cutout of your home? No. Would you be okay with the blueprints to the home? Just the book about the home. Is that okay? No. Will you be willing to take a home in a neighborhood that's not that far away, that's already built? No. I want it to be just like this. I'm very particular about what I have to have. If you want the real deal, you have to wait till the process is clear through the city and through the banks and pay the highest fees to get this specific grounds. Church, do you want the Lord to build this house or do you not? It's always a process of dealing with this legal separation. There's always a process of dealing with it. And are we willing to take the true process and deal with this unfair mess that we are in? We didn't take the fruit. So we were born into a predicament. It's unfair under a certain light. It's unfair for the son to be taken away illegitimately. It was unfair for the husband to be taken away illegitimately. It was unfair for the house to be taken away so illegitimately. And it was unfair for us to be unright with God when we were born. But we are born in a predicament that is very, very serious. And so God is looking around. Who wants to seek my face? If you're going to seek my face, I will speak to your heart and you will know firsthand of how you can separate soul from spirit and know me truly and not just have a cardboard cutout about me, not just to have a book about me, not just to have a weekly gathering about me, but you can actually know the Son. Are you willing to go through the true process of dealing with the issues of separation so you can come back into harmony with the bridegroom? The bride of Christ and the bridegroom coming together on earth. I'm interested in becoming a Christian, and I'm clear that there's a separation between the bridegroom and me. And I'm willing to wait where I have to wait. And I'm willing to pay whatever I must pay. And I'm willing to prove my conduct by taking up my cross every single day and count all my crowns but lost that I may obtain Christ. I'm not willing to take a cardboard cutout of Jesus, and I don't want just a book about Jesus or a false Jesus. I need the real Jesus. I need the real Son. I need the real bridegroom. And I know the devil's going to try to get you to accept the cardboard cutout or just a flat, powerless Jesus that can do nothing and say nothing. Just a book about a Jesus that we forgot about the waiting and the cost and the conduct. The bond between mom and her son is indescribable. And the bond between the wife and the husband is indescribable. The bond between the church and the Son of God is absolutely, eternally, powerfully, fearfully indescribable. Hallelujah. And no, the church will not accept any substitute. We must have the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And there is a legal separation, separating us. The sin has separated us. We forgot about evangelizing to further us. And if we will go back to this, the Lord will meet us again. Are we going to seek him so he can speak to us anew? So we don't have to wonder what verse to look at. He will be the living verse that day, that moment. Amen. There are two world views, the world philosophy and the word philosophy. There is a place where they connect. Like stealing. Both the word of God says it's wrong and the word world says it's wrong. They both agree there. The word likes to comply with all the needs of the world and God as he is. The world likes to think of themselves and not worry about others as much. I know it's hard to say this, as I know that there are many non-believers who do hold to the reasonable morality, sometimes better than believers, oftentimes. But the main thing is God. And this is God as he is. We have to see God as he is, and his word as it is. The word made it all, and the word of God holds it all together, and the word of God will judge us all in the last day. And when we hold to mindsets that are not, when we hold to mindsets that are not in true union with his word, then we will see things come out of line and will make a mess of all reality. As we are having fun carrying on with our ways, we'll make up a whole brand new reality as we're having fun carrying on in our ways. But they will eventually snap back into place and will appear that everything is coming unglued. That's because the mindset you live by would rip the entire universe apart. If the mindset of an unfaithful person would be the reality, all the universe would be ripped apart, as the Bible says. All the foundations of the earth would be destroyed if the Lord's word was not holding it all together. So we have to learn to work with nature. We have to learn to work with supernature. And all of it has been come by the word of God. In the beginning, God spoke. And everything is in a certain motion. It's all mathematically laid out. It's all moving in by sound, by music, and by everything that God has made. It's all in sevens and twelves. And God expects us to know that. He says, by the things that are made, everything about who God is all clearly seen by the things that are made, so that no one has an excuse. Yes, there's two different mindsets. One will leave God as he is on his throne of all, and one will remove him from the throne. One way or another, he will not have the rule over all the mind of the world and false faith. He will not have the rule over all. He will not have the rule over all in the mind of the world and in false faith. There's a lot of people who believe in God to some degree, but it's still a false faith because they really don't see God for who he is. And they don't see his word for what it really is. They haven't taken it for what it really means. If we know that we're not as close to God as we like to be, then we know that we have room to grow. And are we positioning ourselves to grow closer to God? If we know that there's nowhere to go but up in the Lord, and his ways are past finding out, would it stand to reason that we're going to get closer to God and position ourselves to grow closer to God? Have you found certain places that you go that make your mind drift from the Lord? Is there places that you get around that you know helps you get on track with God? Will you make plans to get around that which is going to help you on track with God, or get around those things that's going to help you make it difficult for your mind to stay on track? If we get closer to God, do you think that your worldview is going to change? That's a pretty interesting thought. Do you think your worldview is going to change? What if an angel took you to heaven tonight? You go to sleep and he takes you out of your bed and flies you up into heaven. And you got to hear about all that you saw, you got to see all that you heard about in the Bible. You can read Revelation chapter 21 and get to see the throne of God. You get to see the stones and all these things in heaven, the pearly gates and the streets of gold. What if you got taken there tonight and got to see all that you've heard about in the Bible about heaven? Got to see it firsthand. Would that change your worldview? Would that change your life? What if the Holy Spirit took you to many miracles in the Old Testament and the New and showed you firsthand, as if you were there, the opening of the Red Sea, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, Jesus walking on water, the chariot of fire taking Elijah to heaven, and all these other great mighty miracles? Would that change your worldview? Would that make you live differently if you could see that for yourself? Would that make you refocus and live to share the word even more? Brothers and sisters, if we do not do this anyhow from just reading the Bible itself, does that mean that we really don't believe the Bible? I mean, if a child really read the Bible and said, this is what it is, that's what Josiah did. Josiah says, this is what the law says, what are we doing? And he changed everything. And I say, if we read the Bible and we look at our life and see this doesn't match up, we better change everything. We better be like Josiah, highly favored of the Lord, pure as he could possibly be. But when he saw more truth, he moved in the truth radically. And anything he could do to make sure his life and his rule was matching the laws of God. We must make sure that our judgments are solid and not partial. We need to learn from many places to see the big picture and not just listen to one Christian view that isn't making history now, or even proving that they're making any difference at all, or even trying to get to a position where they're going to make a difference at all. Carrying on in certain mindsets has its place, but we have to find in history when churches were at their finest moment. When did a revival come down? When did the Spirit of God come down? When were people powerful and holy and separate and evangelizing, and families were strong? Families are the glue that binds everything together in the natural faith, in the natural form, as the Lord has designed it to be. And in the Spirit, evangelism is everything, because it will coincide with your separateness, your prayer life, your honesty and your purity. Everything is touched when we see the natural family, the eternal evangelism. Put these both together and whammo, the church cannot fail. Yes, hold to what we know, but don't stop there. Amen. Let's seek God further than ever and see how far a soul can go with the one and only Savior. Amen. So should we be wise to make our decisions because we take plenty of time in the world of God, and let us shape our lives? So should we be wise to make our decisions because we take plenty of time in the Word of God and let that shape our lives? I think that's what we should do. We ought not to be so confident in our views unless we are spending ample time in the Word of God and other things of God that's going to be refreshing our minds. Because there's a lot of different things the devil can make you look at. The truths in your life under a wrong light, just slightly off, can be a really big problem. Could you imagine there's two people going to a goal and one is just a little bit off, and over time he's going to be way off course. It might not look like a problem now, but way down the line he'll be way off course. The little things matter to the Holy Spirit. We rightly divide the soul from spirit. The Word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, dividing joint from marrow and soul from spirit. The Word of God divides soul from spirit. They're not the same thing. We got to come back to where the power of the Holy Spirit can really come. Being refreshed by its contents daily, how easily it is to slip away from our strong devotion to the Holy Spirit. I was talking to the wife about people who are very absolutely committed to things no matter what. And I said, now that is awesome to see people holding on to very important things, holding on to your job when it's a bad time. With too many hours being treated bad, you're still holding on in marriages or in friendships and church connections, and things are not always going right, but you're holding on. I love the attitude of being absolutely committed. I want the church to remember those two words, absolutely committed to what? This, everything the Lord shows you, absolutely committed every moment of every day. I'm absolutely committed to purity, absolutely committed to the Word of God. Everywhere I go, I am for Jesus Christ. Lovingly, respectfully, I love God, whether I'm around a bunch of Muslims or whether I'm a bunch of the gay parade, or whether I'm at a church that I agree with or a church that I don't agree with. The Lord showed me who He is, and I know who He is no matter where I go. I love when people are absolutely committed. And I think that's one of the things that we can say. I'm a pillar because you can know I'm always going to be here doing the Lord's work. So people can come there and you're like a pillar. Like the Word of God never changes, God never changes, and your faith in God and His Word never changes. You're just like a rock. Share the touch. Yes, preach the gospel, but share the touch that God has done. The God of the gospel has touched you. We can share what God has done in our lives. How the grace of God has changed our lives, amen. We overcome the devil by the word of our testimony and the blood of the Lamb, amen. Share our testimony, not just the word of God. Talking to people in the universities, and they said, if you want to get people's attention, preach pain, because everybody knows about pain. And I said, that's an interesting thing. You know, the Bible says, be all things, all men, that we may win some. Now we can say, you know, I've been in pain. Have you ever been in pain? Get their attention and start to talk about things pertaining here, and then bring it over to the gospel. Bring it over to your testimony. He says, preach. Don't put us down. Just share your experience with the Lord. He said, preach pain to get our attention, and preach what God did for you, and then we can just make our own decision from there. Interesting. You know how you see people doing things you don't like? You want to give them advice? Well, he gave me advice politely, and that was really cool. Messes do happen in our life, but let's not plan on having any. Let's try to keep them to a bare minimum of almost nothing. Let's try to be ahead of the game when it comes to messes in our life. We want to have a very organized life, our organized home, organized churches, and be ready for mistakes when they happen, but we don't want to live like they're going to happen. Same as like sin. We don't want sin to just kind of carry on. Shall we continue in sin, let grace abound? The Bible says, God forbid. Same with our lives in the natural. We want our lives to be clean and organized, so we always have a strong slate of everything's in order, so God's free to do things, and he knows everything's in order, and he can build from there, and not building on a foundation of carelessness. Being gracious when things do go wrong, but live like ambassadors for Christ. We ought to be organized in our lives. True salvation, which I'm getting to, we're done here. True salvation, I want us to look at the thing that's going to unify all believers. Like, I used to be very against a lot of different denominations, and now I'm not, because I don't really have the time to, and all the denominations, they don't even always agree with themselves anyway. Duma was a Baptist, so I can't make fun of Baptists anymore, but because there's God's moving among the Baptist church, and did among him very strongly. True salvation and sin. Sin and salvation is a topic I love to bring up so all Christians can unite. Sin is wrong, we all know what that is, and salvation is God's work in our hearts and unifying us with Christ the Son, bringing the bride back together with the bridegroom today and eternally. True salvation separates us from four aspects of sin. The penalty of sin, so we get to go to heaven and not hell. The power of sin, so we can be set free from being under the power of sin. And the pleasure or practice of sin, and God, like the Bible says, God forbid we continue in sin. And the presence of sin when we get to heaven. So true salvation will separate us from the penalty of sin, go to heaven. Power of sin, we're not going to continue in it. We're not going to be overpowered by sin. The practice of sin, we're not going to continue because we're not under the power. We're going to be set free. Whom the Son sets free from living in sin is free from living in sin. That's what it says when we say it's proper context. And the presence of sin. When we get to heaven, we will not be in the presence of sin. So what false salvation preaches is the separation from the penalty of sin. And when we get to heaven, the presence of sin. But they don't ever tell you, you must be out of the power of sin. Because the Bible says that the soul that sinneth, it shall die, first of all. But it also says that if you sin, that you're a slave to sin. That means you're overpowered. So they take away the main part. They take away our responsibility of warring against the flesh. Like Paul says, I beat my body. He's like whipping himself, so to speak, spiritually speaking. I beat my body into subjection. I make my body go where it doesn't want to go. Because my body always wants to run to selfishness, but I want to run in the right way, so my body will be filled with light. Amen? So he says, I beat my body into subjection. I make my body go where it's supposed to go, so I don't become cast away. I don't become a castaway and end up going on the wrong path to the wrong heaven called hell. We got to remember there's more than just the penalty of sin we're forgiven from. If we don't stop sinning, are we really forgiven? The Bible says that there's no sacrifice for those who continue in sin. So all four for true salvation must be remaining in our understanding. Yes, we can be free from the penalty of sin, but yes, we want to get out of the power of sin and out of the practice of sin and out of the presence of sin eternally. False salvation only focuses on the penalty of sin. Hey, you're free from the penalty of sin no matter what, past, present, and future, your sins are forgiven. That is not biblical. That is not biblical. Powerful ministry must be respectful to many other people. We've got to stand our ground, but we don't want to be careless with the way we bring our strong convictions. And the Holy Spirit is our true guide. We will know for sure. We do want to get back to the truth of Jesus Christ, where the body of Christ can truly come back to the real person of Jesus Christ. Like Paris Rehab says, with all of our plans of salvation and all that we have done, have we neglected the person of Jesus Christ? Has the faith that we have embraced, has it introduced us to a living Christ? And has he spoken to us? And is he leading us? We have to go back to this. If we can see a radical call from Tozer and Reedhead and a lot of these giants in the Holiness movement and honoring all the denominations and saying, look back. Can you see how different things used to be? Even back then, they were saying something is very wrong with the church. Something's very different. They're not hearing from the Lord the same. They don't have an urgency to holiness and souls anymore. They don't have an urgency to protect the families and sanctity. There's a lot of playing going on in the church among the men and women. There's a lot of players, spirits. There's a lot of compromise, prayerless, careless perversion going on in the pulpits. It's very, very dangerous to see how many pastors are falling from sexual perversion. If he says only 1 out of 10 40 years ago is born again, or even 50 years ago, how much more sober do we need to be today? Amen. The person of Jesus Christ. We don't want to settle for a cardboard cutout. We need the Son, we need the Bridegroom, and we want to let him build our house legitimately. Amen. Father, we love you tonight, God. We thank you for your word. We thank you for helping us see, Lord, the way you see things, God. Lord, I pray that you would cause this message to do what I could never do, Lord. You make it real to people, Lord. It's never going to be by might. I know it's not by might and not by power, Lord. It's by your spirit, Lord. It's only by you that can make your word real, Lord, and your testimony for the hour real, God. I pray that your Holy Spirit would cause divine revelation of the glorious risen Savior, the true Bridegroom of the church, the true Bridegroom of the body of Christ, the true Bridegroom of the bride of Christ, Lord. To let him be seen by the church who is so willing. There's so many people, God, that is willing, God, and we need you to speak to us again. We need you to direct us once again, Lord. We're going to take up our cross, and you could look across the world and find some of us seeking your face, Lord. And those who are seeking, please begin to be speaking. Please to begin speaking again, Lord, that we can really know the separation that you're calling us into, that we don't want to play church anymore. We can see something is very wrong, Lord. We can see that we're not affecting the world. We can see the governments of this world that are wicked, Lord, that are being praised by those others who don't care about your law and honoring them and following their every way and running from things that don't even exist, Lord. But Lord, your church, who's ready to hear your voice again and to be confident, Lord, we know that there's nothing to fear when we're following your Holy Spirit, Lord. You're the CEO of the universe, and in whom shall we fear when we are following your voice? We love your book, Lord, but that's not all we want. We want the author. We want the author of the book to be our author, of our finisher, of our salvation, our faith, Lord. Strengthen our faith anew, Lord. Cause our faith to be activated once again. Cause our eyes of understanding to see a living Savior once again. Reveal your glorious Son to your church, Lord. They're hungry for him. They want him, Lord. That we want to know the truth, Lord. We don't want to play games with you. We know that there's something wrong, and we know we're ready to go to the next level, Lord. We're ready to throw down everything for your call, Lord. We're ready to throw everything away that we may know you, Lord. We don't want to play church, Lord. We don't want to gather in your name only. We want to gather with you in your house, Lord. We don't want to kick you out of your own sanctuary and say we don't even miss you, Lord. We want to know, yes, we miss you, Lord. We want you to come in your power, in your sweetness, in your glory, in your wonder, Lord. Come again to your people, Lord God. Help us to be filled with your awe-struck wonder, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. The notion of divine control. How much more shall your Father, which is in heaven, give good things to them that ask him? Matthew 7:11. Jesus is laying down rules of conduct for those who have his Spirit. By the simple argument of these verses, he urges us to keep our minds filled with the notion of God's control behind everything, which means that the disciple must maintain an attitude of perfect trust and eagerness to ask and to seek. Notion your mind with the idea that God is there. If once the mind is notioned along that line, then when you are in difficulties, it is easy as breathing to remember. Why, my father knows all about it. It is not an effort. It comes naturally when perplexities press. Before, you used to go to this person and that, but now the notion of divine control is forming so powerfully in you that you go to God about it. Jesus is laying down the rules of conduct for those who have His Holy Spirit, and it works on this principle. God is my Father. He loves me. I shall never think of anything. He will forget. I shall never think of anything He will forget. Why should I worry? There are times, says Jesus, when God cannot lift the darkness from you, but trust Him. God will appear like an unkind friend, but He is not. He will appear like an unnatural father, but He is not. He will appear like an unjust judge, but He is not. Keep the notion of the mind of God behind all things strong and growing. Nothing happens in any particular unless God's will is behind it. Therefore, you can rest in His perfect confidence. You can rest in perfect confidence in Him. Prayer is not only asking, but an attitude of mind, which produces the atmosphere in which asking is perfectly natural. Ask, and it shall be given to you. Wherefore, my dearly beloved, flee from idolatry. I speak as to wise men. Judge ye what I say. The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we, being many, are one bread and one body, for we are all partakers of that one bread. Behold, Israel after the flesh, are not they which eat the sacrifices partakers of that altar? What say I then? That the idol is anything, or that which is offered in the sacrifice to idols is anything? But I say that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to devils and not to God. I would not that ye should have fellowship with devils. Ye cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of devils. Ye cannot be partakers of the Lord's table and the table of devils. I like to look at the sincerity of the table of the Lord. I know it's one of the most important parts of the house of God, is the table of the Lord. And you see in the next chapter, in 1 Corinthians 11, where you see him dealing with some issues of them not handling the table properly. And this is where we see that he wants us to take seriously that we don't want to use the cup for anything other than to remember him. And God will cause a spiritual remembrance to happen when we come to the table of the Lord and we take the elements with Him. He will cause us to know deep in our soul what took place on that old rugged cross. It was a legal transaction that happened 2,000 years ago at Calvary on Golgotha between two thieves. The most powerful legal transaction in world history took place that very day. Jesus was the propitiation. He made atonement and provided the expiation for the salvation to take place completely. Many things took place in there. You could spend volumes of books on and on about what happened on the cross and so many elements to the thing. But here we would do it to remember as children before the Lord. Simple and plain, Jesus died for our sins. A miracle that we could never understand. We will never really know what happened on that cross. It's just so great to know that Jesus Christ was delivered into the hands of sinners. And as they were eating, Jesus took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And let's take together. And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins." Heavenly Father, we thank you for the old rugged cross. Thank you for the power of the blood of your dear Son. We thank you for the power of the gospel, the power of your word, power of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for your mighty authority, Lord, that we can always come under and be safe, Lord. We thank you for the wonder-working power of your precious blood, Lord, cleansing us a brand new and giving us a brand new beginning, Lord, in you. Lord, we're warring to stand before you unblamed, God, and we want to be unrebukable before you and pure before you as children, honoring our Heavenly Father. Cleanse us anew, Lord, as we glorify and praise your worthy name. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Forever and forever. Jesus, that ye may with one mind and one mouth, glorify God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Lord, for tonight, God. We thank you for blessing the service, Lord, and helping the word and the songs, Lord. And I pray that you'd continue to go before us in the seasons ahead, in the living situation and everything, Lord. I pray that it would all be in your hands, Lord. Please, great shepherd, lead us, your sheep, Lord. And we give our life to you brand new. Thank you for your blessing upon us and your forgiveness and your strength that you cause us to have. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.